Good morning. Welcome to Open Mics with Dr. Stites. It's Wednesday, January the 25th. I'm Dr. Steve Stites, Chief Medical Officer at the University of Kansas Health System. We've all heard the saying, three strikes and you're out. But for the woman you're about to meet, 3 years of unsuccessful cancer treatments may be just the thing that saves her life. Christina Medina explains.
Tell me, how's everything going on since we saw you last time?
Basically, no news to report.
Mary was diagnosed with multiple myeloma in September of 2019, a cancer that attacks plasma cells.
It was pretty advanced. I had collapsed vertebrae, and it was extremely painful.
Finding the right treatment was not easy.
He started treating me with chemo, and my first chemo worked very well. Unfortunately, I was allergic to it, and I broke out in hives and a rash from head to toe.
They tried four chemotherapy treatments that were also unsuccessful. In 2021, Mary's care team tried a procedure called CAR T cell therapy.
It was successful. My cancer numbers went down. The only thing was it only lasted about 9 months.
Mary's pain returned along with her cancer.
It exploded is the way the general cancer doctor said. He said, this is, it was everywhere.
That's when Mary was offered a new drug called tetlistamab. The FDA had not yet approved the treatment that forces T cells to recognize myeloma cancer cells and attack them. One treatment later, Mary's scan showed a miraculous change.
I was very surprised, and the before and after pictures just speak for themselves, I think.
Mary's care team said if her remarkable results continue, she can go from weekly infusions to every other week. For Mary, that means more time with family.
I have 11 grandchildren. One thing I plan to do, I want to write each one of them a letter, and I'd like to travel. My husband loves to travel.
And some of that travel will certainly include seeing those grandchildren.
Always a pleasure to see the grandkids. This is the greatest, the joy in our lives right now.
Her advice for anyone else battling myeloma?
Hang in there, because this is a drug that worked really well for me. Would it work for someone else? I don't know, but I would say to immediately call this cancer center at KU and get with Dr. Abdallah. Love this guy.
With us here in the Dolph Simons Jr. Family Broadcast Studio, two of Mary's doctors, Dr. Joseph McGuirk, the Director of Hematologic Malignancies and Cellular Therapeutics at the University of Kansas Cancer Center. Also, Dr. Alola Abdallah, a multiple myeloma specialist in hematology, also here in our cancer center. And of course, Doc Hawk will join us to give us our latest COVID count. We're hoping some better COVID numbers, and we'll talk a little bit about some stuff coming out of the FDA. Yeah. We always love getting questions from our audience, so make sure you send those to us. They're an important part of our program. Get yours sent in to us now on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and the Medical News Network. You'll find links to those right here on your screen. Jessica Lovell will join us a little later with those questions. Okay, so team, that was an amazing story about Mary. Kind of reminds me of that show, There's Something About Mary. There's Something About Mary. After 3 years of treatments, a lot of people might be discouraged by the setbacks, but then this treatment came along and changed everything. Dr. Merker, talk to us a little bit about that therapy.
Absolutely. Leveraging our knowledge of how the immune system functions and how it lets us down when we develop a cancer has allowed us to develop tools like CAR T-cell therapy and antibodies. And this antibody that she received most recently is a two-forked molecule, basically. One part attaches to the cancer cell, one part attaches to the patient's T-cells. Those T-cells get close to the cancer cell, they punch a hole in them, release molecules that race through that hole and chop up the chromosomes inside of the cell. And we've seen some remarkable results, including in patients who have failed prior CAR T cell therapy. Now, the CAR T cell therapy that she received was the first generation. We have a new kid on the block, CAR T, that has response rates of 97% and complete remissions of 65 to 80%, depending on which study one looks at. So this is a time of riches for our patients, an extraordinary development in cancer therapeutics using the immune system to kill these cancers, and highly effectively so.
We're going to come back to this story because this is such a miraculous thing. But let me first turn to Dr. Abdallah. Tell us about this new medicine, tetlistamab. It's now approved by the FDA. How does it work? Who's a candidate for the drug? Were you surprised that it worked so quickly?
Sure. I mean, as Dr. McGuirk was talking about it, like it's an antibody, and specifically this antibody works with the T cells and the myeloma, specifically a target called BCMA, B-cell maturation antigen, which is now well known. It's 95% present in myeloma cells. And as Dr. McGuirk actually talked about, that it activates your own T cells to attack the myeloma. So it's really an immune therapy treatment for our myeloma patients. This got FDA approved recently, and the patients who are candidate for that, as me and Dr. McGuirk have been always talking about, that they have to have a good performance status. They are many patients who got a lot of lines of therapy, and they relapse multiple times on many options, and most likely the major classes of therapy for anti-myeloma, like the immune modulatory drugs, the proteasome inhibitor, and the CD38 monoclonal antibodies. We highly recommend to kind of evaluate the patient that they should not have any underlying neurological problems like Parkinson's disease or all these stuff. So we have a committee every week to kind of meet and make sure that we are delivering the treatment to the right patients in order to get a better response and also to have a lower toxicity for these patients. One other thing is that, was I surprised about the treatment and the results of her? Of course I was, for several reasons. The onset of the response was really fast, as on the clinical trials itself, it was about 1 month, the median onset for the response. In this patient, we saw it in the first week, and we're talking about like multiple masses has decreased in size. Another reason also I was surprised that this patient got prior CAR T cell, and we didn't have any good data about how this type of treatment will react after patients relapse on CAR T cell. So we were really impressed about the results in this patient.
So if this is such an amazing drug, why don't we just start with teclistamab all the time in myeloma?
Well, I mean, so far we have a lot of options of therapy for multiple myeloma that can get patients in remission. This treatment, as clinical trials, has been designed for later and after many relapses. However, we are believing that it is going to move up front with CAR T cell, and we need more clinical trials and randomized trials, and we believe that more of the clinical trials that's coming out that proving it's better than the standard of care. So I think this is going to actually move eventually upfront therapy, but it's not recommended to start yet upfront until we have more trials to prove its efficacy comparing to other standard of care.
Well, you know, I may, Dr. McGuirk, have turned a little year older here today, but and I've been in medicine for approximately a very long time, and you and I go back a really long way, back when we used to poison everybody with chemotherapy. Yes. These changes are so remarkable to me, and our younger generations don't even remember how bad it was back
in
those days.
Absolutely, that's right.
But talk to us a little bit about how the T-cell therapy has come along. I mean, it is one of the biggest therapeutic developments in cancer, like, ever.
Absolutely. We're in the middle of a revolution, the likes of which we've never seen in cancer therapy. And again, it's on the shoulders of men and women who have worked in laboratories across the world community, particularly and certainly in our nation. And better understanding the immune system and what goes wrong when cancers are allowed to propagate. The immune system's important job is not just to fight infection, but also to recognize abnormally behaving cells and attack and destroy them before they become full-blown clinical cancer in our patients. And so things go south when they do develop a cancer, and part of that story is certainly in the immune system. So leveraging that knowledge, as I mentioned earlier, is really based on stem cell transplant back in the 90s and the early part of this century, where we saw that the T cells from the donor were actually bringing about the cure in the patient, not the chemotherapy and radiation therapy. And that led subsequently to the development of genetically modified T cells in the laboratory using the patient's own T cells. But we're moving even beyond that now, and we're using what we call third-party T cells to make CAR Ts. Rather than using a patient who has had cancer and received multiple chemotherapies where their T cells may not be optimal, they've been beaten up with chemotherapy and let the patient down in the first place, but rather taking an 18-year-old college volunteer who gives us T cells, genetically engineering those. And we have such studies currently underway at the University of Kansas Cancer Center. This is making a big splash in the world because we're seeing patients go into remission who have failed all other standard therapies. As a matter of fact, in the most common form of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in adults, CAR T-cell therapy is a curative therapy for a substantial percentage of patients who absolutely would not have survived previously, 7% 2-year survival in those patients. So these are really stunning advances. It's moving rapidly. Dr. Abdullah and I are both blood cancer doctors, but we have a number of trials now in solid tumors as well. And so in breast cancer, in prostate cancer, in lung cancer, in liver cancer. So when this starts becoming effective in those cancers, it's really going to be a time when we can look at the light at the end of the tunnel. The days for chemotherapy, non-specific, very toxic chemotherapy, as you mentioned, non-specific radiation therapy, are numbered, and we will see those therapies recede into history as these immunotherapies continue to come to the forefront. It's really a remarkable time.
This is a remarkable time, and again, I grew up doing some ICU care together, and you'd see all the poisoning and and this is just such a game-changing moment in our history, in our collective history in healthcare. And I every time I hear about it, you guys come on, I read the scripts, I'm like, I'm so excited, Ron, because I was a part of the old stuff, and the new stuff is so much better. All right, we put a QR code up on the screen so you get more information on some of the treatments available for multiple myeloma and other blood cancers here at KU. It's a really big deal, and another major cancer programs across the country. Okay, Dr. Abdallah, do we know approximately how many teclistamab treatments a multiple myeloma patient like Mary requires to treat their disease?
That's a great question. I mean, I think the issue here is that we always have to understand that patients who got relapsed refractory myeloma in this stage, they usually have limited options of therapy. And unfortunately, every time the myeloma is relapsed, because it's not curable, these patients more likely are going to relapse. We have to keep them on treatment, especially if we get them in remission, in order to keep them a longer duration of response, So these patients are required to be on a continuous therapy. Hopefully that this is actually going to have what in the future, a fixed duration of therapy, like once we get them in complete remission, we can stop the treatment. The one thing that teclistamab have behind the CAR T cell is that teclistamab, it's an ongoing treatment that we give it weekly and sometimes every other week. However, a CAR T cell, it's a one-time treatment that we don't have to give the patients afterward any maintenance therapy. So for these patients, when they reach this stage, we highly recommend to continue the therapy with using the teclistamab until they either progress with disease or they cannot tolerate the treatment, with hopefully that we can decrease the frequency for these patients.
This is a pretty big darn deal, too. And I bet you would echo the comments that Dr. McGuirk made about what a revolutionary time this is in healthcare.
It is definitely a revolutionary time.
All right, so we've talked about how money. Is it fair to call the teclistamab a cure?
Well, it's too early for that. And the reason for that, we have just this trial that got, a response rate that's amazing. And patients who are having, staying in this in remission for a year, comparing to the old history of the patient before the CAR T cell, the best response rate we got was 30%, and some treatments that FDA approved was only single agent 4%, and they barely stay in remission for about 3 months. We're talking about a year moving it to stay in remission, and patients who got into a deeper response, they can stay in remission for over 19 months. So I think we need longer follow-up for these patients, more clinical trials to see how effective this treatment is, and if there is a fixed duration of treatment to stop it in order to see if these patients can stay in remission longer than that in the future.
That'd be pretty amazing. And is there ever a chance you can do another CAR T therapy treatment, or is that one time, one and done?
Yes, no, that's a really important question. We are doing second CAR T cell therapies in patients who have progressed after an initial CAR T cell therapy and seeing significant responses. We have a clinical trial now for patients who have failed CAR T cell therapy, receiving a CAR T cell therapy directed at a different molecule on the surface of the cancer cell, and we're seeing response rates of 60%. It's important with regard to the question about are we curing patients. We're employing these therapies in the absolute end of the line worst case scenarios. And so, as Dr. Abdallah pointed out earlier, Dr. Stites, as we move this up earlier in our armamentarium and it makes it to front line at some time point, we're hopeful that we're going to see those long, durable remissions and potential for cure in multiple myeloma.
Define it. What is a long remission, long, durable remission in your mind? Well, how long is that?
Forever.
I like that word.
Yeah.
That's a good word, right? So is it a game changer, Dr. Abdallah?
I'll tell you this. Two CAR T cells that FDA approved, the idacel and the ciltacel with the teclistamab, they all target the BCMA. They use the cellular therapy. This is going to be the future of the game changer. There's many of these trials coming out, many of these bispecific and CAR T that target other things. it is actually the definition of game changer in the landscape of myeloma. So in my opinion, I think, you know, except the availability of the CAR T cell, but I think it's going to be solved in the future. This is going to be some, these treatments are going to be required for all myeloma patients to receive.
That'll be awesome. Dr. Burke, how common is it to fail multiple therapies before, like Mary did, before you find one that works?
In multiple myeloma, Dr. Abdallah would tell us that it occurs in virtually all patients. Myeloma, in contrast to some of the lymphomas, has historically been considered an incurable disease. There are a very small percentage of patients who are in remission for very long periods of time, 10, 15 years and even beyond, but those are very far and few between, unfortunately. So we need to change that dynamic, and we're hopeful that these immunotherapies, as I mentioned, as we move them up into the front line, is going to be a, not just a game changer, but a stunning game changer. And these constructs are being optimized in our center, in our cancer center, research in laboratories across our nation, so that if we're getting 97% overall response rates, complete remissions of 60 to 80% in some of these patients, and then durability of a year or a couple of years, what is it about the cell that's letting us down after a couple of years? That's being figured out. And as we figure that out, we modify those cells in a different way. So we are going to get to the point that we are with lymphomas and start seeing cures and plateaus and relapse. So virtually all patients today are destined to relapse, I say today, based on prior therapies. We don't know yet about teclistamab and about CAR T cell therapy, and we're very hopeful.
Dr. Abdallah, I don't know, you're younger than Dr. McGuirk and I. I'm just postulating that. But still, describe to me what it felt like when you're talking to Mary and you saw the scan before and the scan after.
I mean, it's kind of, and I'll be honest with you, before I came to University of Kansas, I was recruited from University of Arkansas. We treated a lot of myeloma patients at the myeloma institution. I saw the old age of, like, transplants that we were transplanting patients, and I'll tell Dr. McGuirk, not only one or two, like, even multiple times, like three or four times. We use really intensive type of chemotherapy. The best response in this stage is to get the patient stable disease or remission, but for only a short period of time. Getting these patients using the newer technique of treatment, including the teclistamab, to complete remission in this amount of time with less toxicity is really impressive. I was really impressed, and I was very happy and glad. And the patient, you know, she was very excited about that, especially when she saw clinically the first results of that. So this was really, and this is kind of like the time, as Dr. McGuirk was saying, this is the time of the cellular therapy that hopefully we're going to start seeing more of these treatments moving up front and changing the course of the myeloma to become more curable. That's our big goal, and that's the road that we're actually heading to cure myeloma in the future.
Yeah, that is so amazing. All right, well, time for us to check in with Dr. Dana Hawkinson, Medical Director of Infection Prevention Control. He's got the COVID numbers. How are we cooking today?
Yeah, good. You know, I love those T cells, both engineered but also natural when they work. So extremely helpful, especially for what we're talking about here.
Yes, it is.
Right now, our COVID numbers are a lot better, Steve, than they have been. 54 total patients in the hospital, but of those, 23 active. Unfortunately, 3 in the ICU and 2 on the ventilator. So those active numbers are going down. That would coincide with national trends as well, both for cases, but also for hospitalizations, which we have said is probably a bit better bellwether of really the actual circulation of the virus out there, just because now most hospitals are including COVID-19 only in those patients that are symptomatic. They aren't testing necessarily everybody that's coming into the hospital.
Yeah, I think it's a pretty big deal. You know, we're 4 weeks out from Christmas today, and the holiday season, and yet the numbers are going down.
Yeah.
That's good, because I was a little nervous that cold weather, people coming in for the holidays, more disease transmission, new variant, the XBB 1.5, and all, but yet the numbers are going down. I think that's a good trend.
Really good. I would agree with that, for sure. And remember, RSV and influenza were also going down prior to that as well.
Which is good. So maybe we're riding the storm out, to borrow from another old song. So next question I had. So yesterday, the FDA started talking about once a year COVID vaccinations, usually in the fall, but to kind of be before the what we anticipate being the peak season for COVID. Thoughts?
You know, I think there's going to be some sort of either yearly or twice yearly vaccination that will be recommended. Would like to say, though, that this disease is now going to be probably circulating, as we have seen throughout the year, not necessarily in a season, but there could be some increasing seasonality to it, like influenza, RSV, and those other respiratory illnesses. The second thing is this illness now, this severe illness, is really becoming a disease of the elderly, especially the elderly, those over 75, but also those comorbid patients as well. So conditions, especially like immunosuppression, like we're hearing our guests talk about today, but also things like diabetes, obesity, heart disease, kidney disease, lung disease, et cetera. So I think there will be some sort of recommendation moving forward for vaccination. What is the best one? It is hard to tell. You know, we know that after vaccination, you have a minimal effect on stopping infection. That probably lasts 30 days or less now with these new variants because they can evade the antibodies. But we know that you have long-lived immunity with those T cells especially, and that is really what is important for protecting against hospitalization and severe disease. So I think that's a start. We still really want to see what is the full clinical benefit of getting the new bivalent booster and what exactly is the boosters moving forward, what kind of formulation will those be. And, you know, we have some early data that those people that were now in the fall and into this early winter period that did get those updated recommended boosters did have reduced rates of hospitalization and severe disease as well. So that does look good, but I think we still need to collect more data and analyze it as well.
Yeah, so I think it is some good news overall. I think an annual vaccination is probably better than a lot more, but I'm not sure it's going to be true for all people. And I do wonder if there may even be biannual vaccines for some other folks. So. Yeah. Hey, some more disappointing news, though. Another HIV vaccine has been discontinued, Hawkeye. It failed to provide protection. Talk to us about that. Why are we struggling so much with HIV?
Yeah, I mean, it's extremely disappointing. Is it unexpected? Probably not. We've been trying to get a vaccine for HIV for 40 years. You know, same thing with RSV. We've been working for vaccines for quite some time for that. We were very fortunate with the SARS-CoV-2 vaccines. The problem with HIV is, although we said that with the vaccines for COVID, it does serve a little bit to help protect against infection, but mostly you have those T cell immune responses that help with that disease. Unfortunately, with HIV, you really need a sterilizing vaccine so that you can have those antibodies that protect that virus from getting into the cell, because once that virus gets into the cell, it starts to replicate. It actually integrates into your cellular genome where it is hidden for the rest of the time until it comes out again and starts to reinfect other cells. So it is vitally important to have those extreme antibody responses to help protect against infecting those cells. And that's really what we've been struggling with. We know that HIV mutates very readily, very easily. It also has protection such as sugar residues on the virus, which help protect it from antibody responses as well. Glycosylation, so, you know, those are big words. I know those are science, but it's just more to the fact that HIV is able to evade our immune system much more than other viruses do. And that is what is causing such a problem, or one of the things that has caused such a problem in really getting a vaccine that works against it to protect against infection and disease.
Well, I think that it's fair to say, I think that the SARS-CoV-2 has a nice big spike protein, which is responsible for prying into the cell.
Yeah.
Gives it a good target for vaccination.
Yeah.
HIV targets are harder to come by.
Absolutely. You know, again, because of hiding, because of sugar residues, but also because of the mutation. And Steve, we talked about this. You know, we know that SARS-CoV-2 mutates as well. But the problem is with SARS-CoV-2, it doesn't integrate into your genome. It is just a different type of virus. And so that is really the main crux of the issue. It's really trying to protect against infection itself. And that is a very high bar to set.
All right, so another headline to think about. Japan wants to downgrade the legal status, if you will, of COVID to the equivalent of seasonal influenza in the spring, a move that would further relax mask wearing and other preventive measures and kind of more of a return to normalcy.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in some ways, we've done a lot of that here already, but what do you think about that?
You know, again, I think we've talked about how all communities really have kind of seen different impacts of COVID-19. That includes different communities, even in our country. And just to your point, though, I think that most of the United States really has been living as COVID has been downgraded. It has become really kind of pushed out. We know people are going about their daily lives. That is maybe some people's definition of pandemic. How does it affect your daily life in different situations? But we know here in the US that really there has been a downgrade of all of those mandates, restrictions, etc. So if Japan feels they can do it safely and they have that immunity, that population immunity by vaccination and infection, and they can protect those most vulnerable people by getting them vaccinated, getting them those antivirals early on in the infection process, then I think that's important. But just as to your point, the United States has been going about that for quite some time.
Yeah, and I think it is just part of our normal daily life now. Yeah. And it's hard to put the word normal in front of SARS-CoV-2 in life. Yeah. But the reality is that's where we are today. And fortunately, we've been able to cope with that a little bit better, especially with vaccination and other therapies. All right, Jess, how are you this morning? I mean, I bet there's no reporter questions, but I bet there's also community questions.
There's always community questions. Good morning. Maxine wants to know, is this treatment for multiple myeloma a clinical trial, or is it now officially FDA approved and available for an option for treatment?
Dr. Abdallah.
It's FDA approved. This has got FDA approved, so it's available more likely in bigger centers like KU Medical Center, because the first first week of treatment, it requires close monitoring for these patients, and institutions such as KU, which is built for that, is designed to take care of these patients. And then after that, these patients can receive the treatment outpatient. But it is FDA approved.
Jenny wants to know, what are some of the symptoms of multiple myeloma?
I mean, the initial diagnosis for multiple myeloma, the majority of the patients will present with bone pain and, unfortunately, fractures that can happen, which is a pathological fracture from not doing any kind of, or if they're doing any kind of regular normal activities when their myeloma attacks their bones. Some of these patients have severe fatigue from anemia when the bone marrow is infiltrated by the myeloma cells, weight loss, and sometimes, you know, if they follow up their kidney doctors or their primary care physician, they might have kidney failure with the myeloma. Some now, you know, more so the primary care physician, when they do the regular workup and the patients are asymptomatic, they can find elevated some high level of the protein and maybe calcium, and the patient's not having any symptoms that can indicate that the patient have multiple myeloma. So it could, most of the time, you can find it like with symptoms, which is bone pain, fractures, or major fatigue and weight loss, but sometimes also it can be found incidentally with when they're following their primary care physicians.
Daryl wants to know if the doctors can talk about the risk factors of multiple myeloma.
Dr. McGuirk, thoughts?
I think that for the most part, we don't know what the risk factors are for the majority of patients, what drives multiple myeloma. It's an area of great focus in our research efforts. There are some familial or family associated cases, but those are quite unusual of multiple patients having cancers of the cells that are associated with multiple myeloma, the plasma cells and the cells that develop into those plasma cells called B cells. But those are far and few between. Those far and few between cases, though, we can learn some important lessons from. And I'll ask Dr. Abdallah, who is our myeloma expert, to comment further.
Yeah, sir. I mean, one of the, as Dr. McGuirk say, like, we don't have really the definition of risk, you know, for multiple myeloma. I mean, we know that the patient's population, those who are age 65 and more, they're high likely to get the myeloma. That's the age. It's not present in younger patients. We know the, you know, gender, males are relatively higher risk, you know, to develop myeloma. Race, African Americans have that high risk. And sometimes they have like a, what we call a pre-malignant condition called monoclonal gammopathy that is fine incidentally. They have a lower chance for it to develop myeloma in the future. But we don't have like the definitive, like in lung cancer, like smoking is related to lung cancer or family history related to that. So we don't have that, these major risk factors that tells us or predict us if they're high risk to develop myeloma.
Jess.
Brian wants to know, what are the more traditional treatments for multiple myeloma, and in general, how successful have they been?
unfortunately, Dr. O'Donnell, not a lot of success historically.
Correct. I mean, we'll say this word. I mean, there have been, like, for the past 10 years, many targeted therapy that came to myeloma and has actually helped to move it. And stem cell transplant is still, although it's an old treatment, but it's still an effective treatment. You know, this is a population of patients that Dr. McGuirk say they can get cured. It's about 10 to 15%, and 40% of the patient can stay in remission for about 8 years, which is still impressive. So we do have effective treatment, but we're seeing now a shift of this treatments, you know, from the traditional chemotherapy now to cellular therapy, immunotherapy. These are newer treatments that are helping a lot to get patients in deeper response and longer remission. So I think, you know, the older treatments are there, but as Dr. McGuirk is saying, we are going to start seeing these treatments, the newer treatments, the CAR-T and the bispecific and more of these treatments moving up front to actually, I will say, either replace these options or, you know, add more, combination therapy in the future for these patients.
You know, Dr. McGuirk, he just said older therapies like stem cell transplants, he just called you old because you and yes. I were here when yes. stem cell transplant started.
Absolutely. And I'll just comment about that. In the year that I started my fellowship at a big cancer center in New York, Sloan Kettering, in the early 90s, when we met with a myeloma patient, we told them at the time that none of our therapies were making a difference in survival, not improving survival, but could improve quality of life for a short period of time. Median survival was 2 years when you were diagnosed with this disease. Now, race forward with strategies like new drugs, with new mechanisms of action, and stem cell transplant, all before CAR T cell therapy and these bispecific antibodies like teclistamab, and we have increased the survival of patients by fourfold since that time. So it's nobody has a discussion about 2 years anymore in the overwhelming majority of patients with multiple myeloma because of those old therapies like stem cell transplant. But the stem cell transplant, and I'm glad to see this happen, we do not wed ourselves to a specific technology. Our job is to look out for our patients' best interests and evolve as the field evolves and the science evolves. And so in our center, we will soon open a prospective randomized trial of CAR T-cell therapy versus stem cell transplant. And we think that's another game changer potentially.
Because you think CAR T therapy is going to blow it away.
I do, and I hope so.
Yeah, that's so awesome. Because, you know, stem cell transplant has its own set of complications and challenges, which we have seen for many years.
Certainly does.
Jess.
Jenny wants to know, when you get these treatments or CAR T therapy from others, do you need to worry about rejection like you would worry with a standard cell transplant?
An old therapy like stem cell, I got it.
rejection is an unusual problem after stem cell transplant, actually. It can occur when you're using somebody else as a donor, but for multiple myeloma, we use the patient's own stem cells for transplantation, so rejection is not a problem there. With CAR T cells, the current constructs FDA approved that Dr. Abdullah was speaking to are both using the patient's own T cells, taking them out of their blood, taking them to the laboratory, genetically re-engineering them to recognize the cancer, expanding them and infusing them like a blood transfusion back into the patient. So no problem with rejection there. But we're moving beyond using the patient's own T cells, as I mentioned earlier, because we don't think that those are the healthiest T cells. We're trying to find those 18-year-old college student volunteers and collect their T cells and turn them into cancer-fighting T cells, and we think there are advantages. But there's a problem with that because when you take that 18-year-old's T cells, they can be recognized by the patient and rejected. So we're actually engineering these cells in a way that allows them to hide out from the immune system and persist and keep killing cancer cells for weeks and months after we infuse them and not be rejected. Very good question.
That is a pretty cool deal. So you just touched on some new clinical trials. Anything else we should know about?
The field is moving very rapidly. There are a number of iterations, somewhat mind-boggling number of iterations that men and women in laboratories across our nation are working on to modify and optimize these CAR T cells so that they're minimally toxic, maximally effective. We get God willing, we'll see the day when we get everybody into complete remission and get rid of these awful diseases. We have a lot of work to do, a long way to go. Yes, we're in the middle of a revolution. We've seen extraordinary results, as you've heard of from today, but not everybody responds, and not everybody who responds to teclistamab or to CAR T cell therapies stays in remission long term. A significant percentage of patients appear to be So we have our work cut out for us to further optimize this. We're just in the first generation of these constructs. So there's a great deal of exploration and progress to be made in the next 5 to 10 years. I think going to be quite dramatic.
That is a dramatic story, and just like we said a moment ago, there's something about Mary. There's something about science.
Yes.
Let's hit some final thoughts for today, guys. Dr. Abdallah, I'm going to start with you.
Well, I mean, as we talked about that, this is kind of revolutionary. I mean, we're talking about the old treatment, and stem cell transplant is one of them. And we're talking about now the newer treatments, the cellular therapy. This is the tip of the iceberg. You know, we have more and more of these bispecific and CAR T cell with more targeted therapy. These results, I'll tell you, 10 years or 15 years ago, when these patients came to our clinic, the best response was to keep their disease stable, and they barely stay alive after that. And now we're seeing that these patients are going to remission. That's really impressive, with minimum toxicity comparing to the old chemotherapy that these patients used to have more toxicity and less response. So this is a small tip of the iceberg that we're going to see more of these CAR Ts and bispecific and revolutionary, hopefully, that will. We're heading to the road of, like, you know, better response and maybe curing the myeloma when it starts moving up front therapy.
And this is such a big and such an important thought. Dr. McGuirk.
Yes, my comment is a general one, and that is that I've been in the field now for 32 years, and I've been excited and optimistic about improving outcomes for our patients. But never have I been as excited and as optimistic as I am today about what's going on in cancer therapeutics very broadly. As I mentioned, we've talked about blood cancers today, but these therapies are moving into solid tumors as well in the investigational stages of limited FDA approvals in solid tumors so far. But we anticipate a lot more positive data to come in the next several years. So this is really an extraordinary, exciting time. I feel extremely blessed to be living through this time period and being able to contribute in our cancer center.
The rise of science and medicine,
yeah,
and the cures that brings us, Doc Hawk.
Yeah, I just want to say, you know, thank you to Dr. Abdallah, Dr. McGuirk, and their colleagues, and it's always a pleasure to work with them. And just talking about the nature and the complexity and the wonder of our human bodies and our immune system, not only fighting off infectious diseases, but also cancers, as we heard, and we're just gonna be able to learn more and do more and keep people well and home and with their family and loved ones.
You know, for those of us that have been in medicine for a long time, these type of amazing results, like HIV patients don't really die of HIV anymore when they take their therapies. Patients with multiple myeloma and all the other things you've done, lymphoma, et cetera, to treat with T cells, the new drugs for cystic fibrosis. Science matters, right? Science matters. And somewhere out in this public discussion the last few years around vaccination, we forgot that science matters.
Indeed.
Jess, back to you.
All right, Dr. Stites. Not so fast, though. Before we go, there is one more item on the agenda.
Oh, no, 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 no.
Oh, yeah.
Time to count, team.
Someone's
we're done.
Someone's having a birthday.
Yeah. Oh, let's look at this. Yeah. Oh, my God. Some of those.
Oh, my God. You have hair.
Grapes.
You have hair.
Well, that was a long time ago. Thank you.
So, Dr. Stites.
Yes, dear.
We know you're on a health journey.
I am.
And so we reached out to your daughter, and we said to Sierra, what can we get him? We don't want to get him cake. And she said,
that's true.
He loves grapes. Here's
I
the
do
thing,
love grapes.
Though, she didn't tell us whether it's fresh or fermented.
Yeah.
Oh, well, both are good. I think so, doctors would say, I need to do more of the fresh, which I tend to do anyway, so that's not a big problem, but thank you.
Anyway, and you said today that I was loving on our docs.
Yeah,
we didn't love you as much, and the crew loves you.
I know. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks to everybody. Thanks, crew.
Happy birthday.
All
we
right.
Love all our docs.
Yep.
Trying to pick one is like trying
we
to
love
pick
our
one
team.
Of your kids.
We love our teams.
Yeah.
That's the best
Happy
thing
birthday.
Ever. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
And thanks to all of you. Thanks to our audience out there. Have a great day, and remember, live long, prosper.
All right, Dr. Stites, I voted for the cake, by the way. The grapes look nice, but I wanted the cake. So happy,
yeah,
happy.
Voted
it's a way to
the 60. With a little red stuff on it.
Maybe so. Is it 63 or 64, by the way?
Oh, God, please. 63. Give me a year here.
Okay, I'll give it to you. All right, everyone, thank you again so much for joining us today. Tomorrow we have an encore presentation of our morning medical update. We'll be back Friday at 8 with our next live morning medical update. Until then, have a great day.
It's been 10 years since Stephanie Reynolds proudly stood and held this sign at Arrowhead.
The fact that they want to pick somebody out of a crowd that's doing something and can say, you know what, I can beat this and so can you.
She's still a Chiefs fan. Her battle with cancer has taken a seat, though, and her game plan now focuses on a new challenge. I'm Jessica Lovell. Meet Stephanie, her doctor, and learn why many women say that breast reconstruction after cancer takes a winning strategy. See you Friday at 8.
Subscribe to our morning medical update and open mics with Dr. Stites podcasts. Now, everywhere podcasts are available.